As you all know, man, we're getting ready to end the year. Amen. Come on. God has been good. He's gotten us through. How many of you at the beginning of the year said, man, I don't know if I'm going to make it. Amen. And in June or maybe July, you were like, Lord, but look at how good God is. He gets us through. Amen. He's faithful. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap. God is always faithful. Amen. But I just want to share with you that during this holiday season, that remember that you and I are the light of the world. We carry the kingdom of God. So in these times where there's so much going on, and how many of us know that even in the holidays, a lot of people can be depressed. A lot of people can go through many things, but you and I, we can be the ones to share, amen, and to let people know that God is still on the throne and God loves them, amen. So during this holiday season, remember that you are a representation of King Jesus, amen. But this evening, how many of you came excited to hear from the Lord, amen? Amen. Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm excited because what God is doing here, he's doing some amazing things. Amen. And you all know we just celebrated 12 years. Amen. 12 years. Come on. 12 years is that's powerful. And God is raising up. Amen. God is raising up an army of laborers, of men and women. And that's the call of the vision and the call that this ministry has to reach, teach, to mend, and to send. And so this morning, if you stand to your, or this afternoon, this evening, wherever you're watching from, stand up. And we have an opportunity to hear from one of these young men. Amen. We're going to call up Brother Hector. He's going to minister the word of God. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap. Amen.
Let's just pray. Father, we just thank you today, Lord God. We thank you for another day, Lord God, that we can to just come here, Lord God, to worship you, Lord God, together, Lord God. Lord, I thank you for what you are doing, Lord God, in this time, Lord God, in our hearts, my God, in the people of this church, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, for it all comes from you, Lord God. It is not by might nor by spirit nor by power, but by your spirit, Lord God. Lord, in this time, I ask that you would just help me to decrease, that you would increase within me, Lord God, that you would give me the words to speak, Lord God, that it would be nothing of me, Lord God, and all of you, Lord God, that you would empty me continually and continue to pour your Holy Spirit within me, Lord God. Fill my heart with your word, Lord God, and continue to let it pour out for these people, Lord God. For you know, Lord God, that there is someone in here, Lord God, that needs a touch of heaven, Lord God. So I ask, Lord, that you would continue, Lord, to speak through me, Lord God. Let it not be my fancy words that amaze them, Lord God, but by your spirit, Lord God, that touches their hearts, Lord. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. All right, guys, this evening I was going to, the title of my message is going to be called The Gift of Prayer. And the first one to start off with this scripture, it's Philippians 4, verses 6 through 7. It says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. But tell God what you need and thank him for what he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Now, the reason I want to speak with this scripture is because when Pastor first told me that I was going to be preaching a message, I was terrified. I'm being real. I was nervous. I had been thoughts running through my mind. I did not know what I was going to preach about. I was like, I kept asking the Lord, why me? I said, why me, Lord? And I kept wondering, I was like, is there someone else who could do it? But I kept thinking about Jonah and how he ran away from the calling, and I did not want to do that. And then I remember one night I was in my bed and I was praying and I was asking the Lord for revelation, asking him to give me what he wanted me to preach, to let me know that he did want me to do this. And I remember opening my Bible, and I was reading Kings at the time. And I remember opening to a portion of scripture when God is preparing Elijah to go up into Mount Carmel. And at the bottom of my Bible, it said, God prepares his messenger. And I knew at that moment that the Lord was with me. So I knew right then and there that as I prayed to him, that he answered me right then and there, that I knew that it was from him. And so the reason I want to talk about the gift of prayer is because I feel that many times as believers, as the people of God, that we can continually forget what God did for us and the power that we have in prayer, that we forget where it came from and how precious it can be to us. We forget and we take it for granted so often that we look at God who is sitting there waiting for us to just come and fellowship with him, and we will put it off for another day. Or we will say, I will go with you later, Lord. And I wanted to read this portion of scripture from Leviticus. I wanted to lay a little bit of a foundation, understanding how initially things went in the Old Testament before we had the New Covenant. In Leviticus chapter 10, verses 1 and 2, the Bible reads, Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, put coals of fire in their incense burners and sprinkled incense over them. In this way, they disobeyed the Lord by burning before him the wrong kind of fire, different than he commanded. So fire blazed forth from the Lord's presence and burned them up, and they died there before the Lord. And the reason I speak of this is because you can see, at that time, before we had Jesus come and die on the cross for us, you see that to come into the presence of God, you couldn't just come however you wanted. You couldn't just walk into his presence. You first had to ceremonially cleanse yourself and bring the right kind of fire and offering to him to enter into his presence. As we go forward a couple of chapters in Leviticus, we go to chapter 16, and you can read about the Day of Atonement, where the high priest at the time would have to unclothe himself and of his linen tunics and put on the linen garments worn next to his body. He had to strip himself. He had to humble himself before the Lord, taking off his priestly garments and wearing something that is very lowly. He had to get many sacrifices for first him to cleanse himself of the sin that he had committed or anything that was in him before he could then enter into the Holy of Holies and preach and intercede for the people of God. There is a long list. I'm not going to read the whole chapter, but you can see though how much that the priest had to go through. It says in verse 6, Aaron will present his own bull as a sin offering to purify himself and his family, making them right with the Lord. Then he must take two male goats and present to them the Lord at the entrance, present them to the Lord at the entrance of the tabernacle. He is to cast sacred lots to determine which goat will be reserved as an offering to the Lord and which will carry the sins of the people to the wilderness of Azazel. Aaron will then present as a sin offering the goat chosen by lot for the Lord. The other goat, the scapegoat chosen by the lot to be sent away, will be kept alive standing before the Lord. When it is sent away to Azazel in the wilderness, the people will be purified and made right with the Lord. Now I read this portion because you can see before he could purify everyone else, he had to purify himself. And all this was taking place before he could truly enter into the Holy of Holies. And in the scriptures, we read later on that this was a permanent law that had to be done every year. And you think about that. It's every year this high priest had to do this to cleanse himself and his people, or else he would not be able to enter to the Holy of Holies, and he would not be able to intercede for the people. And now we know, Lord, I mean, brothers and sisters, that Jesus has done that for us. As we go ahead into that's the Old Testament, right? And I want to relate it to the New Testament. So we look forward on into the New Testament in Hebrews, and we read about how Jesus became that high priest. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 5, A little bit before 5, forgive me. It's chapter 4, verses 14, and then it goes into 5. The Bible says, "So since then we have a great high priest who has entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we believe. This high priest of ours understands our weakness, for he faced all of the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy and we will find grace to help us when we need it most." Chapter 5 starts as, "Every high priest is a man chosen to represent other people in their dealings with God. He presents their gifts to God and offers sacrifices for their sins. And he is able to deal gently with ignorant and wayward people because he himself is subject to the same weakness. That is why he must offer sacrifices for his own sin as well as theirs." And then we see a little bit further down that Jesus did not honor himself as a high priest while he was here on earth. But once he was sacrificed on the cross, he became the high priest for us in heaven. And we all know that he sits at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for his people and allowing us to be made holy and walk into his presence. In John, Matthew chapter 25, we see here that at the time of Jesus' death, Jesus not only paid the price for our sins, he did not only bleed his blood to cleanse us of our iniquity, but at the time of his death, it reads that the veil was torn within the temple of God. It says here in Matthew 27, verses 50 through 51 from the Amplified. "And Jesus cried out again with a loud, agonized voice and gave up his spirit voluntarily, sovereignly, dismissing and releasing his spirit from his body in submission to his Father's plan. And at once the veil of the Holy of Holies of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks were split apart." And now, we look at the two times of prayer. The two times, we look at the Old Testament and the New Testament. We see in the Old Testament, the priest could not just enter into the presence of God. He could not just walk boldly, as it says in Hebrews, into his presence. He first had to humble himself, taking off the garments, the priestly garments that were beautiful, and put on linen garments. He had to get a bull. He had to sacrifice that bull, sprinkle the blood 7 times on that altar. He had to do all these things to walk into the presence before he could even make his request to God. And now in the New Testament, we see that Jesus has torn that veil, that veil is no longer there, and we can walk boldly into his presence and make our requests known to him. And now that we know that it is much easier, we look at time and time again as believers, like how many times do we, with such an easy way of entering the presence, do we neglect that presence? How many times do we look at God, like I said earlier? We look at him. He is there waiting for us. It does not take anything from us. We do not have to go buy a bull from the market. We don't have to buy anything. All we have to do is come with humbled hearts, ready to hear from him. We have to humble ourselves. And that's how times can be very hard for other people. It's the pride in our hearts that keeps us from seeking his presence. It's that pride that keeps us away from him. But Jesus just wants to be there with us. He just wants to fellowship with us. He just wants to hear our voice. We look at the way Jesus would pray. In John 17, it's a whole prayer from Jesus to the Father. And many times you will see that it's not just me talking to some random guy. It's talking to the Father. He says it multiple times. He speaks to his heavenly Father, asking that he would be glorified. He prays for the people, and he knows that there's that relationship within him. And the word also says that he knew his heavenly Father as we should ourselves know our heavenly Father. This is not just a religion, a religious way of speaking to him. We're not just speaking to anybody, we are speaking to Jesus. And it is important that we also remember that, that we would remember who God is, that he is the Holy of Holies, that he is the creator of all things, that he is not just anybody, but that he is the creator of heaven and earth as well as our Heavenly Father. And I speak this because many times we can come into the presence and we just think that he is anybody. We can be so irreverent to who he is that we just talk to him like he's anybody, like he's anybody off the street. But he is not just only anybody, but he is the creator of all things. He is the Prince of Peace, right? And now we look forward in Ecclesiastes. I want to read this portion of scripture to kind of give you guys some perspective. Ecclesiastes verse 5. Forgive me. As you enter the house of God, keep your ears open and your mouth shut. It is evil to make mindless offerings to God. Don't make rash promises and be hasty in bringing matters before God. After all, God is in heaven and you are here on earth, so let your words be few. And now the reason I bring this scripture up is because we can see, as I said before, we can be irreverent and just speak anything. And now we can talk to God, we can talk to him and bring everything to him, but we also must remember that when we come into his presence, we are not just speaking to anybody. It's like if you were to go meet the president, or if you were to go to meet a business owner, anybody on this earth, right? You wouldn't just come with, like, if you have a meeting with him, you wouldn't just come empty-minded and without anything in your mind to ask them. You come expecting something from them. You come with a conversation. You come with a question, something that you truly want to know. So when we talk to God, church, it's not just about just coming in and just being so flippant with him, but it's about making our requests known to him. As Jesus said, you make your requests known. We seek and we speak to him. We don't just make rash offerings. We speak with genuineness in our hearts. And as well, there's the portion of scripture in Matthew where he talks, where Jesus talks about when he's teaching the disciples how to pray at first, and he says, "Do not babble on as the pagans do, for they think that their many words get them the hearing from God." Because it is not our many words, guys. It is not the words that we can speak. It's not being a poet. It's not, we don't have to be Shakespeare. We don't have to speak like these people did in the Old Testament. Now, we can, but it's about where does it come from? Does it come from an earnest place to seek God? Does it come from the truth that he has placed within us? Does it come from wanting and needing something from the King, wanting to be in his presence, the longing that we have for him? Where does it truly come from, church? Are we speaking to him because it's something that we're supposed to do, that we've been trained, that we've been told over and over again, church? Is it something that we do only because either our parents are watching, people are watching, that because there are people who think that we're so holy? It can't come from that. It has to come from a genuine, earnest seeking of his presence, church. It comes not only to the highest people in the church. It's for anybody, church. It's for the lowest, the new beginners, and the long-term beginners, the people who have been in the church for years, church. Now that we understand that the gift of prayer is a powerful thing, we understand what it took to get this gift. It was paid for at a high price. It was not only bled for, but beaten. Jesus did this. Jesus died, like I said, not only to redeem us, but to also open that passage that we could enter into his presence, right? This is something that is special to us as believers. It is something that is special to God. So let our words not just be idle words that we speak to him. For the Bible says that he knows what we're going to say before we say it, that he knows what we're thinking before we think. He knows everything about his church. So let what we truly say to him be from the heart, and let it be the groanings of our heart and our spirit that is seeking after God. Let us not just continue to cast away this gift that has been given so preciously to us, Lord. Let us not just treat it as another thing, for it is the foundation, the building blocks of our faith. How can we continue about our days? How can we tell someone about Jesus if we don't ever come and speak with him ourselves? How can we be in the same building as him and never truly know him? It is as if I would be walking around amongst this building and I would see my brother Damien and never speak to him. But I know of him, but I don't know who he is. It's in that same way that we come into his presence to know him, not to just know of him, but to truly know him, to commune with him, to sit with him, to read the word with him, to cry with him, to praise his holy name. In that same way, it can't just be something that we do here at church. We should not do it for the glory of man. We should not do it for their praise, but for the glory that God gives with us. Though the Bible says that he sees you in that secret place, and that prayer that you do in that secret place, what you do in that place will be rewarded in public. It's not about being out here in public. Like, we can come out here and preach and sound so amazing, but what are we doing it for? Are we really doing it for him, or are we doing it for ourselves? It's about doing it to truly know him. And so we read that just about the importance of prayer, for through prayer, many things can happen. Like, I am a product of prayer. I can truly say this, that if it wasn't for the prayers of the people around me who loved me and cared for me, if it wasn't for my sister being up at night praying for me when I was out there in the world doing something dumb that I shouldn't have not been doing, that I would be here today. So we understand this, that prayer is not just a gift, but it is powerful. That it provides believers with a tool to move things in our favor. And it may not be just always in our favor, but it's in the will of God that we move it. Because it's God's will that at the end of the day matters more than ours. It's what he wants to happen, not what we want. And at many times that can be tough, but we know in the end it's true, and it is good, because the word says everything works out for the good of those who love the Lord. Everything that we ask for in his will, he will give us. The word says, if you seek, you will find. If you ask, you will receive. And if you come knocking at his door, that the door will be open. So church, why would we not come seeking him? Why would we not come and ask him for something? Why would we come to the creator of all things, the one who moves the mountains, the one who delivers his people, the one who split the Red Sea, the one who sent the fire from heaven? Why would we not ask this God to move on our behalf? And why would we doubt his power? Why would we doubt what he can do for us when we've seen it time and time again all around us? But it's in our hearts that we say, nah, he won't do it for me because I'm a filthy sinner. Because I did this, this, and this. Because I was out here doing that. But it's remembering that it's not about us. It's about him. And the word says that, how are we going to call something unholy that he has called holy? And it's remembering that, church, that he died for us, covered us, clothed us in his grace, covered us, clothed us in his righteousness, that we can truly make that request, that we could ask him for these things. It's not about our power. It's not about me, my words, but it's about his spirit and my heart towards him. And it's knowing that he delights in giving us things. He wants to give us something. The Bible says Matthew. In Matthew, verses 9 through 11. Your parents, if your children ask for a loaf of bread, do you give them a stone instead? Or if they ask you for a fish, do you give them a snake? Of course not. So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask of him? So church, we should be making those requests to God. We should be there in His presence making that request and boldly coming into the throne room, as Hebrews has said, and seeking His presence, seeking His face. Now, we shouldn't do it, just like I said earlier, with a flippant heart, disregard for who He is, but we should come with reverence for who He is. The Bible says in here in Hebrews that God heard Him. God, while it says, while Jesus was here on earth, He offered prayers and pleadings with a loud cry and tears to the one who could rescue Him from death. And God heard His prayers because of His deep reverence for God. So because of His deep reverence that He had for the Lord, God was able to hear. He inclined His ear to hearing what He spoke. And at many times, we will say anything. We will come in here and be irreverent and just ask Him for, God, give me this. God, can I have that? It's like, God, give me. Like as Pastor says, my name is Jimmy. But it's not about that. It's about coming to God with an earnest heart and truly asking Him, like, Lord, there's this person at my work who is dealing with so much things, Lord. Can you move on their behalf? Can you shift these things that are going on in their life? That can you give them that peace that I have gained? Like, why would we not want to pray for that for others? For it's His will, and it's when we know that what it did for us, how could we not extend that same gift unto others? You know, it's about bringing it to Him. It's about laying it all at the altar. It's about emptying our hearts to Him. And we just continue to just treat it as if it's another conversation. And so I just wanted to remind us that in every situation, doesn't matter what situation we find ourselves in, that if we would come and just pour it all out to God, it's coming to Him and just being there in the presence with Him and allowing Him to move in our hearts, allowing Him to speak, that we can find that peace. Because anytime that, like I said in the opening scripture, when you are, if you're worried about anything, don't worry about anything, but pray about everything. So why should we worry about what tomorrow holds for us when we know that the author has it in His hand? Instead of worrying about that, just pray. Sit there, ask Him, bring that request to Him, and make it known to the King. For He did not just die that we could be saved. Yes, He did die for that, but He also gave other tokens in the process. He gave us other gifts. He gave us other ways of speaking to Him, like as the gift of tongues as well, that the Bible says that we would pray for that, and that we would continue to pray in the Spirit and pray in tongues as well. It is a powerful tool that we should not neglect. And I say this, just church, so that we could continue to get back to a place of prayer. As Pastor has been preaching lately about the basics, about the foundations, it's doing the basic things that will build us up into powerful believers. This is the only, it's the lifeline that we have to God. It's the breath that He gives us. It's the continual just air that He's been pumping into us, prayer, and allowing us to just lay it all down, to not be in our flesh, putting to death the old ways and really seeking His face. And so, church, I just wanted to end it there for you guys and call up Pastor Fernando to finish up.
Amen. Stretch your hand forward. Let's pray for him. Amen. Father, we just thank you for this young man, Lord, and Lord, just obedience, God, and man, what a powerful word. I was sitting there, Lord, and just wanting more, God. But Lord, we know that in due time, you're preparing him for something great, God. And I just thank you for his life, Lord, and what you're going to do through him. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Praise the Lord. You can remain standing. I won't take long. I don't want to take away from that message. But the beautiful thing is how God is raising up men, amen, that are willing. And one of the things about Hector is the whole time he's been here, he maintains that spirit of humility. Amen. And how many of us know that God will always use the humble? Amen. Willing to do whatever it takes. No complaining. And I remember, like he said, I'm here because of prayer from my sister. I remember when Gabby was praying for him. Amen. To be able to witness her brother now, amen, share the word of God. That's powerful, amen. That's powerful. That's why we should never stop praying. And I'll close with this. It's important not only to get back to the basics, but to remember what prayer does. It was God hearing people cry out that God prevented the destruction of certain things in the Bible. It was God hearing the prayer that God would come and rescue his people. Amen. It's through prayer. And it doesn't have to be King James. And it doesn't have to be, like he said, very simple. It doesn't have to be with these words that you think are going to impress God. You don't need to impress God. He knows you. And he wants you to speak to him like a father. Amen. You don't have to pull out the Greek or the Hebrew to speak to your father. Amen. And I think that that's the importance, that we get back to that. To get back to just saying, Father, I need you. When you're struggling, if you're mad and you're angry, say, man, God, I can't shake this off. Amen. Or God, I'm in a situation where I don't know what to do. God, I'm battling with this certain situation. And how many of us know that that's what God wants? Your heart. What's really taking place in your heart? Because in the world, you were good at faking it, but you never really made it. You convinced yourself that you were okay, but not with God. We can't lie to God. We can say words and we can do certain things, but the truth is, God knows our heart. Amen. God knows our heart. So lift up your hands. Father, I just thank you here tonight, Lord, for that word, God. That, Lord, as Jesus died, Lord, that you tore that veil, God. And that now, Lord, we don't need a high priest. That now, Lord, we can come boldly before your throne, God, and bring every petition, every request, every prayer, every supplication, God. And Lord, at times, Lord, when we don't understand, we can come and cry to you and just say, Lord, I need you. And Lord, I believe that there's people here tonight that are in that place that just, they just need you, God. They need you in that area in their life, Lord, where it's gotten difficult, where they don't understand, where they've gotten a bad report. Or maybe, Lord, where their minds are just so bombarded, Lord, that the enemy's brought fear, depression, anxieties, and even oppression. But Lord, we come to you tonight, Lord, together, lifting up our hands and God asking you, Lord, to search our hearts. Help us, Lord, as we walk forward in this new season, God. This new season, Lord, that you're going to get ready, Lord, to do something great to those that are faithful. I pray, King Jesus, that, Lord, we would not be ashamed, that we would not be afraid, that we would not be too prideful, Lord, to get on our knees and say, God, I need you. God, I need you. I need you in every area of my life. So, Father, tonight, search every heart, search every mind, God, and bring them rest. Bring them peace. Bring them comfort. Bring them your shalom. Father, we love you. Father, we praise you. And if you receive that message tonight, can you give the Lord a hand clap?